Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in Southern California, Bakersfield area. God bless you guys. I'm getting ready to head out this coming week to the Las Vegas area. I'll be seeing those people who I saw last time, and as I said, any new people there, let me know. I bet I've got at least 100 people that are asking me for a word, brothers and sisters, more and more and more. I'll do my best to work on it, maybe 20 at a time, as the Lord leads me. Anyway, I had a couple of dreams. I think I want to put those on here first. I had these dreams last night, a whole series of dreams about the Antichrist, brothers and sisters. And what happened is the first dream I had, I was out, I was getting ready to go for a walk, and my wife was with me, and I was tying my shoes and outside. And the sky was real funny looking, and it kept getting funny, and I was saying, you know, what's going on with the sky? It's so funny. And it's weird. Something's not right. And then I kept watching and watching. And then the sky actually turned to, it became plastic. The sky was plastic. I mean, I could see. This looked like a plastic fake sky. And then there was like a, you know, a circle vortex, like a tornado, but it was clouds, kind of like that thing that I talked about. The Lord showed me was really like the, you know, what they call in science, a stargate, you know. It was like a stargate. Opening up, a swirling vortex of like a white clouds. And it opened up, and then someone started coming, ascending through that. Even though things were kind of weird, I thought to myself, hey, maybe it's the Lord. And then I saw that this person was dark. Not like, you know, the people that think it's Obama. Not skin dark in that way. But dark, as in black, as in evil. And it, of course, he looked black, like a shadow. It looked like Jesus, but it was like a shadow. You know, it was black. It was evil. And it was coming down, ascending. And the thing that I thought of was like Thor. It was like Thor or something, you know, coming down to earth. And then I heard a voice, you know, like what Jesus said, for the nation of Israel, flee from this, flee to the mountaintops. And that is the word that the Lord gives for the nation of Israel. And that is in Matthew chapter 24 as an example. And he's talking about when Jesus said, when you see the abomination that causes desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Now, there was an abomination before that when this guy, Epiphanes the fourth, whatever. He was one of the leaders when Alexander the Great died. He said, let my kingdom go to the strong. It was divided among four of his generals. Now, one of those generals' branches, which is now Egypt and all that, there was a city of Alexandria and all that, like the library at Alexandria. So that branch, those four branches of the kingdom of Greece before the Roman Empire rose to power, between the time of the end of the Greek Empire and the rise of the Roman Empire, there were these four kingdoms. And one of the leader of one of them, which is now modern day Egypt and all that, and was still Egypt, of course, was part of that. His, as I just mentioned his name, Epiphanes the fourth or whatever, I can't remember his first name. Anyway, like in 165 BC, he kind of fulfilled what Daniel said in the fact that he stopped the daily sacrifice, all this stuff. He changed the times and seasons. And he went into the temple and they say he sacrificed a pig on the altar in the temple, which was an abomination that causes desolation. And then that was the time, if you read, if you have a Bible or if you go read the Maccabees and all that, which is the apocryphal books, not included as canonized Holy Scripture, it still is a historical record of what the Maccabees did. And what they did is because of that dude who outlawed Judaism and everything, they rose up in rebellion and actually defeated that empire, and they actually became independent for a while under the Maccabees. So, you know, that's a historical fact. But Jesus, speaking about 150 to 200 years after, well, it's about 200 years because it's about 30 AD, about 200 years after the time of this abomination of desolation that causes desolation, Jesus said again, you know, that's the Feast of Hanukkah comes from the cleansing of the temple after that guy sacrificed the pig in there. It's an extra biblical feast, the Feast of Lights, the Feast of Hanukkah, the miracle of the oil that lasted 8 days for the cleansing of the temple. Why did he have to cleanse the temple? Why did he have to cleanse the temple? Because this I keep saying Sennacherib. He's the one that I keep thinking of him. He's the one, the head of the Assyrians that took the northern kingdoms captive, 780 or 750 BC. Sorry. I love to throw things out to confuse people. Just not on purpose. Well, maybe a little bit on purpose. Anyway. So Jesus spoke a couple of hundred years later and said, when you see the abomination, it causes desolation. So spoken of by Daniel the prophet. So that first one was a shadow that's not in our Bible. You can see some of it from the Maccabees, and you can look at the writings of Justin Flavius, Flavius Josephus, the writings of the, you know, he was one of the, I'm going all over the place. I'm throwing all this history out there. Lots of people that love the Lord, they want to hear this stuff. If you're not interested in the Lord, sorry, and the history of Israel and the church. Anyway, he wrote all the histories of the antiquities of the Jews, and it was, you know, he was a servant to the Roman emperor, and he wrote all the history of the Jews. He even wrote about Jesus and said that, you know, there's this guy who people are saying is the Messiah, and, you know, they're a sect, you know, and he talked about that, you know, confirmed that Jesus was a historical figure. For those who are, you know, who are atheists or whatever, who doubt Jesus was a historical figure, this guy who was a historian wrote that. But the thing about that guy, I just wanted to say, who I'm just talking about, this historian, Flavius Josephus, he was one of the Essenes. He was where the Dead Sea Scrolls was. He was in the radical, ultra-Orthodox branch of Judaism that was up there where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. Those people, you know, they ended up jumping off of the cliff up there at Medina. Instead of being taken captive by the Romans, they were under siege for several years. They actually threw themselves down and killed themselves. And their writings and their library was found, and it's known as the Dead Sea Scrolls, where you find the Book of Enoch, the Copper Scroll of Isaiah that was like from 600 BC. That's why they call it the Copper Scroll, you know, the place where the Israelis keep those Dead Sea Scrolls. The building is shaped like a Copper Scroll, and the Copper Scroll is on display in there, the copy of the Book of Isaiah. Anyway, let me go back to the topic. Somewhere in there. Anyway, so the abomination that causes desolation, the Antichrist will enter into the Temple Mount. And I just want to say this for those, you know, who are obsessed about Obama, and they get their theology from, people on YouTube who are looking at upside down pictures from, you know, from the devil and his children, and trying to say it's messages from God. I made a video one time, and the Lord had showed me that, like Judas betrayed Jesus, Judas is called the son of perdition also, just like the Antichrist is called the son of perdition. He's a type of the Antichrist, just like that guy who offered the pig before the Maccabees revolt in about 200 BC, 180 BC, whatever it is. He is also a type of the Antichrist. And that's why I made a video and said the son of perdition will betray the king of the Jews, meaning that the Antichrist will betray, like Judas betrayed Jesus, the Antichrist will betray Netanyahu as whatever, the prime minister of Israel. So people automatically, because they've been conditioned by the lies of false prophets on YouTube, immediately said, Obama's going to be, you know, they associate the son of perdition with Obama. That's not what the Bible doesn't list him. The son of destruction, the name for the son of perdition is really word is destruction or the destroyer. And the word is Apollonia, from Apollyon, Apollo, who ascends from the second heaven and comes back. And people will say, who is like unto the beast? Who can make war against the beast? He's called the beast. The Antichrist is that people call him. The Bible talks about the spirit of Antichrist and the Antichrist in 1 John. The book of Revelation calls him the beast. Who is like the beast? Who can make war against the beast? The world will wonder after the beast in one moment. They will wonder after the beast. The whole world. He will do lying signs and wonders. So will the second beast, a.k.a. the false prophet. Anyway, so I saw this coming down. And the Lord had given me a verse right before I left the Philippines. I haven't had time to really study it, but it's connected to this. I mentioned this a little bit in the video. As I said, the book of Revelation, let me explain it for those, because sometimes people are easily confused. in the book of Revelation, it says John saw the things that had happened, things were happening, and things that were going to happen. God, the Lord said, told John, let me show you what's going to happen after this, the future. And what I'm saying is the book of Revelation is not necessarily A happens, B happens, C happens, D happens all the way to the end. A and B can be happening at the same time. So what the Lord had just shown me, this is a new revelation. I haven't had time to study it out. And I believe the Lord is showing me that there's seven seals and the seven trumpets and the seven bowls. I think there are, some of those things are happening simultaneously. And I haven't gotten into it. But what I'm saying that the Lord just showed me, and I haven't had time to study it, is that the first seal is connected to the first trumpet and the first bowl. And then the second seal is connected with the second trumpet and the second bowl and the second vial or bowl all the way through. So the thing that the Lord had given me right forward at the Philippines was the fifth trumpet. When the angel begins to sound, there is an angel or a messenger that falls from heaven, not descends. Sometimes it talks about an angel descending from heaven. In this it says he falls from heaven. An angel falls from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit. And he opens it up. He lets out these scorpions, or these like angels or beasts with tails like a scorpion that sting people for 5 months. It's the fifth trumpet, sting people for 5 months. And the captain over them is Apollyon. Apollyon. The same one, it says, who kills the two witnesses is the captain over the bottomless pit, Apollyon. That is the spirit of Antichrist. Either Apollyon or Apollo is interchangeable in ancient Greek text. Apollo or Apollyon will descend himself and be the Antichrist himself in the form of a man, like the two angels that appeared at Sodom and Gomorrah, or some man will become possessed by Apollo or Apollyon and do the work of the Antichrist. Probably mid-trib, when he receives a mortal head wound, it appears as if he's dead. It appears as if he resurrects to, you know, to be a mockery of the resurrection of Christ. And at that time that he is resurrected is when he will be resurrected by the spirit of Apollo and become, you know, this beast. Whereas before, he is a man who makes the peace treaty. And that's a theory versus Apollo, him coming down himself. And that's two main theories. And those are the two theories that I believe is one of those is the, you know, how it's going to happen. Anyhow, brothers and sisters, I'm throwing out all these different things because the Lord keeps showing me about it. So then at another dream, I woke up. I had several different ones. Some of them I need to meditate on. But anyway, I saw what I thought was the Lord Jesus Christ walking by, you know, like the Lord was passing by. Saw his robe. As soon as he got in front of me, I saw him from the side. It looked just like the Lord Jesus, but then I saw his hair was black. It's like I focused in on his hair, and it was black, 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 evil black. So it wasn't the Christ, but it was the Antichrist. So that's the thing you need to remember about the Antichrist. He will be like Jesus, but a twisted, perverted version of Jesus. So anything you could think of Jesus did, he's going to be like trying to copy that, but in a twisted, perverted way. In other words, it would not be surprising that he's going to be a homosexual, because Daniel says that the Antichrist has no desire for women. So it's a high possibility he'll be homosexual. He'll probably be 30. I'm just assuming or guessing he'll be young, like 30, like the Lord was 30. He will, you know, do his ministry as it, just like Jesus did his ministry for 3.5 years. Of course, there's two halves of the tribulation. The first 3.5 years divided by the abomination that causes desolation, and the second 3.5 years known as the Great Tribulation. And I've mentioned this before. Some of you may be new watching my videos. What happens is, what the Bible tells us, is that there will be someone who makes a 7-year covenant, confirms a 7-year treaty with Israel and her neighbors to divide the land of Israel. And they will rebuild the Jewish temple, and then that's all part of it. When you see the land divided and the Temple Mount divided, and they say, oh, we're going to let the Jews rebuild a new temple on top of there, they're going to start doing animal sacrifices, and there's going to be peace in the Middle East, and everybody's hugging and singing Kumbaya. Whoever makes that deal, that's the Antichrist. He comes in the peace. He's the first horseman. He comes in with a bow, but not any arrows. And he has he's given a crown. Crown represents authority. He becomes the prince of the false peace. Everything you think about Jesus as a prince of peace, the Antichrist is a prince of a false peace, a temporary peace. He'll come to power. And that's the beginning of the tribulation. And as soon as that happens, the two witnesses will appear in Jerusalem at the Wailing Wall, and no, they're not American Gentiles on YouTube, and they will begin to speak that Jesus Christ is a fulfillment of the law and provoke Israel to repent and turn to Jesus. That's their purpose, to be a witness to the nation of Israel, two witnesses, that Jesus Christ is Lord. There'll be supernatural power of calling down fire from heaven, making it not rain, just like what Elijah did, speaking that Jesus fulfills the law. Now, there's the 144,000 witnesses from Israel who go throughout the world, and they cannot be touched for a season. Later on, they'll be able to be martyred later on in the tribulation, but not for that season, as God said, he would seal them for a season. Now, in the middle of the tribulation, in the first half of the tribulation, the Israelis will not know he is the Antichrist. But the abomination that causes desolation that Jesus talked about, the Antichrist will go in, the Bible says he will go into the temple, not at some ice sculpture in Bethlehem or whatever, like what people talk about Obama. He will go in up to the new temple, which hasn't been built yet. So the abomination that causes desolation cannot happen because the temple has not been rebuilt. He will go up there on the Temple Mount. He will enter the temple and declare himself to be God. He will declare himself to be God. It is an event, not the fact that people have Satan in their heart is not the abomination that causes desolation. Jesus said, when you see the abomination that causes desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place. It's not inside somebody. It's going to be in that literal place. If that was the case, then the abomination of desolation had been going on since the beginning, since the garden. So there wouldn't be nothing for us to see. There wouldn't be nothing new about that, that people were evil. And it's not about, we are not the holy place. The Lord was talking about the temple in Jerusalem, because he said, when you see that, flee from them to the mountaintops. You know, and he says, and he talks about, don't pray that it's not on a Sabbath and it's just not in winter and you're not pregnant and all that. He's talking about the nation of Israel. Now, the Bible tells us they go to a place that's called Basra in the Bible, but we know it as Petra, the Rose City, in the desert of Jordan. They will go there and hide after the mid-trib with abomination that caused desolation. We see that in Revelation chapter 12, how the dragon will try to spew water at them and stop them, and then the ground will open it up and suck up the water, and they'll be able to escape. And God will feed them with manna there for the second half of the tribulation until he returns. The Lord will first appear in the air at Basra. And it says, who is this? The Bible tells us this through prophecy. Who is this that comes to Basra with his garments, vestures dipped in blood? It's when the Lord will destroy the armies of those who are destroying the earth. He will leave. He will appear to Basra. The Israelites will mourn for the one they pierced, as if someone mourns for an only begotten son. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. Then they will say, who is this? That, where did you receive your wounds? And he will say, I was wounded in the house of my friends. Zechariah chapter 14. And then the Lord will go to the battle of Armageddon, and he will destroy the Antichrist and his army. I take that back. He will go there first. I'm sorry, I got it backwards. He will go appear first in the heavens. For every eye shall see him. He'll be coming on the clouds, and he will destroy the Antichrist and the armies of the Antichrist with the brightness of appearing and the word of his mouth. Then he will go to Basra, reveal himself to Israel, and then he will touch down on the ground on the Mount of Olives, Zechariah chapter 14. It will split in twain or in two, and a river will come out of it. And then he will walk across the Kidron, used to be valley, because it'll be level at that moment. He'll walk right across what is now the Kidron Valley, through the Golden Gate or the Eastern Gate, right into the Temple Mount to rule and reign 1,000 years from that location. That is the sequence of events, the main points of what's going to happen during the tribulation period. But the Bible says, brothers and sisters, that we are not appointed unto wrath, but to obtain salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. The whole tribulation period is the wrath of God, the wrath of the Lamb. It's not just the second half, the whole thing. The Antichrist is the manifestation of the wrath of God. Antichrist cannot come to power until the Lord allows him to, when he removes his Holy Spirit through his church from the earth. The restrainer is removed. That's the Holy Spirit through the church. And all hell will break loose on this earth. And Jesus said there had never been such a time from the creation of the world, nor will there ever be another time like the tribulation period. And if Jesus said if those days were not shortened, no one would survive. No flesh would survive. But God shortened it to a 7-year period. And that is known as a tribulation that is for the world and for Israel, not for the bride of Christ, a.k.a. the true, real, born-again Church of the Living God. We are going home. We're going up in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. at the last trump. And no, it's not the last trump of Revelation, because as I've said before, the Apostle Paul wrote that letter in about 50 or 55 AD. John did not write Revelation until about 40 years later. Now, interpretation of Scripture 101 is you cannot come up with a different interpretation than what it meant to the original audience. So when Paul wrote that verse to the Thessalonians at Thessalonica, they would have had no idea what he was talking about the trumpet judgments of God from the book of Revelation. So therefore, there's no way that what it could have meant. It means the last trump of the church age, or it means the last trump on the day of the Feast of Trumpets, which is highly likely that is what it's referring to. The last trump is the last blast of the trumpet before sundown at the end of the feast of the two-day Feast of Trumpets. Brothers and sisters, I will add to that as a caveat that no man knows the day or the hour, just like the Feast of Trumpets. No man knows the day or the hour. But it might not be on the Feast of Trumpets. I want to say that. But I've always thought, since I first became a pastor and I first studied it, it's very highly likely that it will be 1 year on the Feast of Trumpets. But it does not have to be. It doesn't have to be. The Lord will come as a thief in the night. No man knows the day or the hour, literally. I got all these list of names of 100 people, brothers and sisters, at least. I've done two sets of 20. I ask you guys to just give me a chance. Give me a chance to work on it. God bless in Jesus' name.